I guess the beginning of decolonizing methodologies has always been about trying to understand our colonizing experience, and trying to understand it not just as a history that was taught oh so briefly in school. It was, first there was us, then the British came, and our lives were forever changed for the better. And I think my, you know, undergraduate journey, I was a history major, but at that time in New Zealand history wasn't taught. The history that was valued was British history and European history. So I actually learnt about imperialism through European history. And it wasn't until I left undergraduate studies that a major in New Zealand history was established in New Zealand. Believe it or not, New Zealand history is not compulsory in our schools. And where it is taught, teachers still have the option of teaching New Zealand history. So that denial of history is a very powerful part of the way we, our country learns to deny colonization and deny our experience. And as you know, when that experience is denied and it's real, you develop a number of kind of psychological and sociological kind of frameworks for trying to make sense of that. So that school on the right, I went to that school. Native schools were established from 1867 onwards. We had to provide the land. We had to pay for part of the teacher's salary. We had to chop the firewood. And we had to make sure that the principal or the head teacher was looked after. Believe it or not, our people were totally engaged in schooling because they believed that it would deliver the promises that we had been given, that it would deliver justice and it would deliver equality. It took some generations to realise that it wouldn't, but it would still deliver to us our own culture and things that we wanted. So Native schools existed in New Zealand for 100 years. By the time they got into their 80th year, they had really become community schools and been transformed. And most of the teachers in the schools were actually Māori teachers or Indigenous teachers. So they became our schools. We thought they were quite successful, and the fact that they were successful in our mind is the reason they were disestablished. And the school system was brought in under the mainstream schools. On your right is the fragment of the Treaty of Waitangi, which was signed in 1840 by Māori chiefs with the British Crown. And the treaty is an important discourse in New Zealand. It's the basis on which we as Māori think New Zealand should be governed, but it was the basis the British saw for their settlement. So from 1840, where we were the dominant population, within 30 years we were the minority population. And in 1856, New Zealand established a settler government and things went rapidly downhill from there. I don't really want to dwell too much on the colonial history of New Zealand, but just two important slides here. One is the suppression, an act that suppressed tohunga. Tohunga were our elders, our healers, our intellectuals, the ones who looked after the life of the community. And because they also were our healers, worked in the health area and looked after our well-being, the government decided that they were a hindrance to us being healthy. And so they passed legislation to make them illegal. It was illegal to call yourself a tohunga, to operate as a tohunga, to give advice as a tohunga. And that, you know, that simple legislative act, that is one of thousands of legislative acts that really wounded our culture and wounded our people. On the right is just one of a number of protests that occurred in the 1970s and 80s. You can't really see the picture, but it's about education. And that really leads me to the next slide, which, if I were to reinterpret our treaty gave us the right to an intellectual life, gave us the right to the legacy of our ancestors. And I think the legacy of our ancestors is actually the legacy of a people who thought, who valued knowledge, and who actually did research. They valued knowledge enough to navigate the greatest waterways in the world, the Pacific Ocean. And they did it purposefully. You don't wash up in New Zealand easily. It's not something you can accidentally find. It's purposeful voyaging. And purposeful voyaging in which in our canoes were men and women. We travelled the Pacific, men and women. It enabled us to settle, men and women. It's very much part of our traditions. So that intellectual life is part really of what I came to think is important when, as a master's student, I tried to make sense of the research texts I was being made to read in a research methodology course. I didn't understand any of it. Or if I understood it, I had that sort of instant wariness about what our research methods was about. And in a simple way, it just made me feel like I couldn't do research. I was the wrong person. That in order to do research, I had to give up myself. And that didn't seem a possibility. I was in a feminist methods class, and one would think that would have been helpful. No, it wasn't. It wasn't helpful. It had some useful tools to analyse research and understand what we were being taught in the academy, but it still didn't speak to me as an Indigenous person. And that's mostly because the literature at the time about Indigenous peoples, you know, primarily anthropological literature, was about describing natives, describing native peoples. And those descriptions weren't that healthy. So when I read them, I didn't read them. I made several attempts, but it's like trying to eat something really sour that you can't stand. You can suck on it so long, and then, no, you have to spit it out. And when I had spat out all of them, I thought, well, this is not going to work. I can't love these texts that I'm being made to read. I'm going to have to think about it. And really, my journey has been about trying to think about it. What does that mean? What does it mean for the way I was educated, the way our society educates people? What does it mean for research, for our ideas about how knowledge is created, produced, made, understood, and then reproduced through what we are taught? So that then has been the 15-year journey. Well, actually, probably 18 years. Parts of decolonising methodologies I wrote as a master's student. Some of the middle chapters, the critique of positivism was something I wrote as a master's student and kind of kept and worked on and thought about, from that time. And I just saved and put things together and reframed them as I moved on. So I think there's some simple messages about decolonising methodologies that you're probably all aware of. That scientific research is deeply implicated in the forms of colonialism, and that it must stop. That academic disciplines have their roots in Orientalism, or what's called Orientalism, of the other, and they need to be decolonised. That research as an institution of power that has been viewed by others as the misuse of power, and that approach must stop. But that also the idea of research for knowledge is something all human societies seek, and that includes us as Indigenous peoples. And research can enhance knowledge and can generate solutions and benefit societies at local levels and upwards. And that Indigenous peoples value knowledge and have approaches to research that can provide benefits for themselves and others. And you'll note from that slide, therefore, that there are two parts to this story, two parts to the book. The first part, which is unchanged in the second edition, was my attempt to understand imperialism and understand cultural imperialism in the way knowledge was thought about, in the way institutions were developed, and in the way disciplines came to be formed. So the first part of the book deals with that. But I've never thought of myself as being anti-research or anti-knowledge or anti-science per se. I believe we actually have a tradition of knowledge in our own communities, and that that tradition was really trashed by schooling. I believe we valued knowledge, and that knowledge was dismissed as irrelevant and ignorant. And I believe that we had answers, and we were able to resolve problems, that we were able to inform ourselves with better knowledge. We had a language that enabled us to talk to each other, to make sense of the world that we lived in. So the second part of the book was my attempt at that time to formulate some ideas, but how can we do that again? How can we revalue our knowledge, but also think about knowledge and research as ours again? How can we restore it to us? What do we have to do to reframe knowledge in a new way? So you will know that I was greatly influenced by writers like Edward Said, who was also influenced by Foucault, by Derrida. I was influenced by Fanon and Mimi and Paulo Freire. So a range of critical theorists, anti-colonial intellectuals, they really became the literature that helped me move forward. I think decolonising research is actually, to me, it's really positive. I get people who think I must have been a terribly angry person to write the book. And actually, one of my head of department, thankfully what he did do was read the book, but he interviewed every staff member about what they had been writing. And his interview with me was, "You must have been so angry." And I was really stunned, because I don't think this book is written in anger. I would have not completed. I think it was written with passion. That's different. Not out of anger, out of a desire to understand. And out of a desire to turn research around, turn it around from being a negative, turn it around from being an abuse of power. How do you shift?